can't tell you how much it warms my heart to see all of you here. Most of you I know, and I know the amazing work you do in our community. Some of you I don't know, but I know that if you're here, you are doing great work in your community and you want to do more. And so thanks for joining us in this fabulous place. We are on the unceded land of the Spokane tribe, looking over the river, which was the lifeline for this community for generations and generations, and still is today. But I want to honor the people who stewarded this land for so long. And I also want to honor the forward-thinking leadership of people to say, let us center our life in Spokane on this life-giving river and all that that means. So I want to thank that. And I'm also, here we are in this amazing new downtown Spokane library. We've got the library director and a lot of library staff who are also 100% committed to belonging. And they were excited to have us, and we're excited to be here. There's probably no institution in Spokane that exemplifies belonging in real practice every day than the downtown Spokane library. Is that true? So before I talk a little bit about what our schedule is today and introduce our speakers, I just wanted to share with you a little bit about how we got here today. Almost 4 years ago, actually over 4 years ago, we decided as a council that we really wanted to upgrade the council office and expand our reach in changing our community and bringing on policy people. So we brought on folks on housing and homeless, on transportation, on sustainability, and we brought in initiative manager on equity and inclusion, which is Alex Gibalisco here. And he started with nothing. nothing in the city, nothing in the council office. And I just said, Alex, help us create something. Just get started. And over these 2.5 years, is this your third year? 2.5 years at the city, he has taken the entire city government and particularly the council to new places and joined you. And a lot of you are here because of Alex, I know. But one of the things that he did, he organized for us, was a very extensive DEI training for all of council a couple years ago. And we sat together and talked together and got content. And out of that, we came up, we thought independently, but turns out there are other people who already figured this out long ago, who you're going to hear from, that belonging was maybe the secret sauce to bringing people together who had been in conflict, who had been excluded and othered, and this idea that in Spokane we all belong. So we started talking about that a couple years ago, and we have been talking about it everywhere. And now, as you may know, we have under consideration to try to adopt a new motto in the city of Spokane, we all belong. But that's just, you know, a bit of a symbolic aspirational thing. We have just been trying to focus on that. And so it's going on. It's like anything. Once you get it in your mind, you see it everywhere. So people are talking about belonging everywhere. They're adding it to their corporate charters, their institutional goals and aspirations. And there's nobody that I know of that has had more to do that than John Powell, who is the director of the Othering and Belonging Institute at the University of California at Berkeley. And so we have somehow attracted John Powell to Spokane. So thank you, John, for coming. But before I get into the mechanics of today, I want to say what he and Ashley Gallegos, who's with him here today, what they told us of why they would come to Spokane is because of the work that you all and we all are doing already. And they are really focused now as a big component of many components of work on places of belonging. And Spokane is a place of belonging, is becoming a place of belonging. And so they were interested in investing their expertise and time and heart and soul into all the work that you all are doing. So that is why we are here today, is to hear from them, to engage with each other, and to continue dreaming and imagining what it really means in real life in Spokane we all belong. So what we're going to do, we're going to have three sessions, and we're going to that each session is going to start off with a speaker, two of the sessions, I think, mostly with John, and then one of the sessions with Ashley. And in the session, we'll do content from front of the room, and then we will engage in conversations at our tables about what this could mean. And we have a break in there, so don't worry about that, but you feel free to take care of your bodily needs or any other emergencies that are out there. Alex has already told you where the bathrooms are. The first session is going to be on othering, belonging, and bridging. And that bridging, I'm really excited to hear. That is the work that I want to hear about. How do we do that bridging between our within and between our communities? The second session is going to be targeted universalism and measuring belonging. And the third is going to be expressions of belonging. What can we do? Where can we go from here? So that's what we're up to today. But we're as interested as anything of what your thoughts are going to be and your dreams and aspirations and how we can learn from each other about how belonging might work in Spokane. I'm going to do just brief introductions. Many of you know of John Powell, and you can go on the website and see all his amazing things. But essentially, he has started numerous institutes. He's taught at numerous universities. He's been an amazing lawyer. He was the national legal director for the ACLU, but he also practiced law in Washington, and he's really focused on people who don't have much voice in the system, and with a particular expertise on housing and homelessness, which is our kind of our jam that we're trying to work with. But he speaks all over the world. He's in great demand, and for me, why I was so excited to explore these issues even before I met him, and watched him, is that he seems to have come up with a clarity of concept of really understanding our divisions in our community historically and how people can come together. It's always been my challenge in advocating for communities that don't have much power or voice or are excluded of dealing with the majority community. How do we build those bridges, which is his term? But in watching him on YouTube and reading his works, I've just gotten feel like an inspiration and something that can quench my thirst for justice in our community that can actually be realized. And that's why I'm excited he's here. One great attribute of a leader and thinker is attracting and developing other amazing leaders. And John has tons of people at his Othering and Belonging Institute, and he's brought Ashley Gallegos here with him. And she is... get your title right here, Ashley. The belonging coordinator at the Othering and Belonging Institute of UC Berkeley, and particularly focused on places of belonging, and works closely with John on all the things that she's done. She has also spent a lot of time in the Northwest doing justice work, working on equity, and creating networks to really seize back community for all people. And with that, let me introduce John Powell.
May know that the Supreme Court just made a decision on an affirmative action case, and so I've been getting texts all over, and one just said the New York Times reading of the case is wrong, and it's from a friend of mine who's a brilliant lawyer, so I think she's probably right. And sort of apropos to some extent that we are having this conversation this morning, so I'm going to share with you some slides. I'm not attached to the slides. I'm much more attached to you. Ashley and I were walking over this morning, and she was saying, you know, you've done this a lot, and you seem to be really, what makes it work? And I said, you know, when I first started doing public speaking, I'd have my notes, and I'd get up, and I'd read to people, and I'd stumble over the reading, and then I'd get to the end of the reading, and say, I did it. And I look up, and everybody's gone. It's like, Where'd they go? When did they leave? And I realized that the real thing about public speaking, or about anything really, is about connecting with people. And so to me, even though we now have PowerPoints and our slides, I really want to make sure we connect. And I lived in Washington for 10 years. We've been working with Washington State. We're leaving here, going to Seattle to work with some of your colleagues. But what brought me here was the president of your city council. I saw a video, and I just thought, wow, who is this guy? You know, call him up. because we are doing this work all around the world. In fact, we were approached by a large foundation, and they said, we love what you're doing. Here's some money. If you had a lot more money, what would your moonshot be? If you could do whatever you want to, if you weren't constrained by money. And I'll just say, I'm holding this phone because I'm going to use the phone to try to look at the PowerPoint so I don't have to keep turning my head, but that may or may not work. And we came up with to make belonging a global norm. But we also know that people need concrete expressions now, that there's an urgency now. And the idea of global norm, just for most people, is like, that sounds good. What the hell does that mean? And so the work you're doing here, the library, issues around homelessness, actually is a beacon for what this means, both in the state of Washington and in the world. Just to give you a little bit more background, I started years ago working with Julie Nelson and the Seattle Civil Rights Division, her and Glenn. And at the time, Seattle and Portland were the two major cities that had a Civil Rights and Equity Division inside of government. As a result of that, there were some policies, including paid leave for parents that Julie had pushed through. And when there's a change of administration, one of the payoffs to corporations in Seattle was to fire Julie Nelson because she had pushed that through in Seattle. I gave a talk at her going away acknowledgement, and literally there were hundreds of people there talking about how over 20 plus years she had affected their lives and helped their children and gotten people out of jail and gotten houses. And I said, that's all great, but now this woman is unemployed. So what are we going to do? And I said, I, for one, I don't have money. I'm a nonprofit. But I, for one, am going to throw down and say, we're going to put some money on the table. And if Julie wants to work with us, we'll pay her something. And we did. And out of that came GEAR, Government Alliance for Racial Equity, with Seattle and Portland being the first two expressions of that in the country. Now there are over 520 government units around the, around the country that's part of GEAR. And I share that with you because, again, it was a small beginning. We didn't know if it would work. And in fact, some people complain when we sort of go around the country, especially to the South, and we say we have this thing, and it started in Seattle and Portland, and we want to make sure we deal with racial equity. And they say, so you work in the two whitest city in the United States, and now you want to bring it to Detroit. but we have brought it to Detroit. And from my perspective, this is what Spokane represents, an expression of this that allows us to take this to the rest of the world. One other quick story, and then I'll go to my slides. You know, I didn't know you were going to have this picture up today. I would want a different shirt because I feel like I do have more than one shirt. but anyway, so in 1948, the UN adopted human rights, the Declaration of Human Rights. And there was a big fight between Eleanor Roosevelt and W.B. Du Bois. They call it the War of the Titans. Du Bois was pissed. He was saying, what is this human rights stuff? You know, people are struggling. Colonialism is still real. Segregation is alive and well in the United States, excuse me, Supreme Court. You know, people are starving. And you wanted them to adopt some declaration? He said, it's just symbolic. People have real pain and real needs. And I'm not for this declaration, this symbolic gesture. As you probably know, Du Bois lost that fight. He was eventually then pushed out of the NAACP. He left the United States and went to Ghana and died there, sort of brokenhearted, in his 90s. But he was right, and he missed the important cue. And as those of you who know his work, he's like one of the most powerful, influential minds in the history of humankind. But he missed something significant. He was right that the Declaration of Human Rights was symbolic. But the suggestion that, therefore, it was unimportant was wrong. 75 years later, we are celebrating the Declaration of Human Rights, and there are all kinds of instruments and procedures and practices that has affected the entire world. But it started with a value and a symbol that that every human has rights. Now, today, that seems obvious. In 1948, it was not. And so we are really pleased to be on this journey with you of saying that everybody, but everybody belongs. And again, we think that has very concrete implications, and we will talk about that some. But we also know it's important symbolically. And some of you who watch maybe some of my slides may know that at a conference maybe 8 years ago, I said that everybody belongs, and there's a circle of human concern with no one outside the circle. And one of the people from the audience says, "What about the Koch brothers?" And I say, they are in the circle of human concern. You can't have anyone outside the circle of human concern. And then some of my friends pushed me further. And they said, "What about the Earth?" It's a good call. And I was, to some extent, rescued by the realization that human comes from the word humus, which means of the earth. That when we really deeply ground ourselves in our humanity, we have to be in relationship with the earth. So in a sense, it's already there. So you've heard why I think this is important, and why I think it's important to be here in Spokane. It's great to be back here. My daughter went to high school here. I love the Northwest. But more importantly, I'm here because of the work you're doing, because you're a beacon. When people say, "Well, belonging, what does that mean?" I'm going to say, look at Spokane. Look at what they're doing at the library. Look at what they're doing with homeless. Look at what they... And hopefully more and more. And it does have implications. I was talking to someone who's in education, and they were saying, we want to adopt homeless belonging in terms of our education foundation. I said, you should. And we're doing that all around the country. And they said, that means we have to end the school-to-prison pipeline. That's an expression of othering. That's an expression of saying to students and families, you don't belong. And I said, exactly right. And your Supreme Court has already adopted an approach to belonging. And for more than 2 years, it's been going through the laws and interpreting the laws through the lens of what does it mean to have a court that's grounded in the notion of belonging. And it's not just your Supreme Court. I just got back from Johannesburg. And that's a long flight. And I talked to two justices of the South African Supreme Court. And I said, my reading of your constitution, it looks like your constitution is informed by belonging. And Justice Albie Sachs, I asked him that question in a public meeting, and he paused. And then he said, I'm looking for a word stronger than absolutely. And then he talked about cases that had come before the Supreme Court. They were hard cases. And they referred back to belonging, everyone belonging, to decide those cases. So again, it's not just symbolic. It actually affects how they approach the world. It's a platform. It's a platform that touches every aspect of our life. So again, I couldn't be happier to be here. And to learn from you and support you and be on this journey with you as we move to make belonging a global norm, belonging without othering. So if we could have the next slide. So othering, interesting word. We have different ways of saying to people they don't belong. We sometimes say, next slide, you don't belong because of your race. Literally, Dred Scott said black people could never belong to the United States, never. That was the U.S. Supreme Court. I wish this current court would read that, remember that history, because it's still here. But it's not just race, it's also our ability. It's also who and how we love. It's also the accent we speak. We have hundreds and an infinite number of ways of saying to someone they don't belong. You're too short, you're too tall. I don't like your color. And when saying people don't belong, bad things happen to those people. And it's one thing to do it at an interpersonal level. I don't like that guy because he wears the same shirt every time he gives a speech. Okay, I'm going shopping as soon as I leave. But that's between individuals. What happens when a government, what happens when an institution, what happens when a library, what happens when a police force, what happens when a housing district says you don't belong? It's very different. And so othering is a problem, and it takes on many different forms, not just in the United States, but around the world. Next slide. And this extreme othering has been weaponized. And one question is, if it's going happening around the world, why is it happening now? What's driving it? It's not just a U.S. phenomenon. And this diagram helps us understand it. Mammals can only process so much change in important areas in a short period of time without experiencing substantial stress. There's some sayings that if you change your marital status, to get married, change where you live, move to a bigger, nicer house, and change your job, in a two-year period, your chances of getting a heart attack goes up 50%. And that's assuming you like the person you're marrying. But even good change can produce stress and anxiety. And what we're experiencing, not just in the United States, but throughout the entire world, is change is speeding up. And it's both speeding up, and there's a sense of we're out of control. Who understands ChatGPT-3? The guy who actually invented it said he actually lays awake at night wondering if he's done a good thing. He's the inventor of it. He now is a billionaire. And he's saying literally he worries that he may have done something that's terrible. I talked to the founder of Twitter, and he says he's an engineer. He's a pretty smart guy. He's also a billionaire. He says, I have no idea how the algorithms at Twitter really work. We feel like we're out of control. And so when we look at the change that's happening, it's happening across many different areas. Climate change, globalization, technology, pandemics. I was on my way to the airport. A friend of mine called me from Ohio, and he started telling me he just listened to NPR. And he said, we're worried about viruses. He said, it's the wrong thing. It's really fungus. He said, I just heard this specialist from MIT talk about all the fungus that's coming to get us. And I said, Larry, I'm not going down this rabbit hole. What are you doing, John? I said, I'm going to get to the airport. I'm not going to worry about fungus right now. But there's this sense that we're losing control. And one of the areas is demographic change. Demographic change in the world will speed up. It has to speed up. And as here in the United States and other places, that become particularly acute. So when we talk about the United States becoming majority non-white, the research shows the anxiety in the country goes up tremendously. And then anxiety is just anxiety. It's like, I don't know how I feel about that. Then we listen to stories, we read books, we watch movies, and they tell us how to feel about it. So the stories matter. Change is gonna happen. How do you feel about it? And there are two main stories. One story is that we're kind of screwed. Life is not good anymore. And if you go home tonight and you're bored and have nothing to do, turn on television and watch a movie about the future. And 90% of the movies about the future are about zombies, vampires, and robots. And people are, you know, back on their heels, running from the zombies, right? So our vision of the future is bleak. We're afraid of the future. And so one story is that the future is bad, and it's those people's fault. Which people? You can fill it in. The trans people, the gay people, the black people, the Muslims, the people from California who are driving up property value. It doesn't matter. The thing is, you're actually exaggerating the fear. Be afraid of them. And I won't go into the great detail, but fear, by many accounts, is the oldest emotion. It's activated by the reptilian brain. The reptilian brain. The reptiles don't even have words, but they have fear. And that's the base of our spine, the old part of the brain. And so that's one reason when someone is afraid, you can't logically talk them out of it. Logic is to the front of the brain, the newer part of the brain, which is small and slow. It's pretty cool, but it's not up to the task of dealing with the reptile. And so when I'm talking to my staff oftentimes and we're writing op-eds and stuff, I say, remember, talk to the reptile. Not to the prefrontal cortex. So what happens then is that this thing that the other is what's destroying your life is called breaking. The other becomes the evil incarnated. And we have to do something to them. So one story supports breaking. Another story is that, yes, life is changing. And now we got good Indian food in Spokane. I used to go to London. I still go to London a lot. And it used to be so boring. And now I say, with a certain degree of seriousness, if you want to see the world, and if you like Egyptian art, go to London. It is incredibly diverse. The whole world is there. And you can eat any kind of food in the world, good, bad, or indifferent. It's a different place than it was in the 1960s and 1950s. We're not going back. So when people talk about the future is fearful, and authoritarian leaders who trade on fear, they always talk about not going forward, but going backwards. Let's make America great again. Let's make India great again. Putin is obsessed with Catherine the Great. Ukraine wasn't even a country when Catherine the Great was alive. So neither was Russia. India talks about the Muslims. They came here and spoiled our country. You say, when did that happen, Modi? It was about 2,000 years ago. So this is obsession with some imaginary past when people were pure, when one group dominated, when one group controlled. That past never really existed. The United States has always been diverse. There's always been conflict. There's never been really a homogeneous society. But it's a story we tell each other. So we tell each other about imaginary futures so we can avoid an inevitable imaginary past so we can avoid an inevitable future. So what does it really look like if we have a future where everyone belongs? That's the future that we're trading in. Next slide. So when you're othered, you know it. Lack of voice, lack of power, lack of agency. So being othered has consequences. It's not just a nice term. Next slide. So sometimes when people hear about othering, they think, okay, we're not going to other. We're going to make everybody just like us. Okay, your name is hard to pronounce. Can you fix that? Can you change it so I'm more comfortable? We're going to have all of our English, all of our instructions in school in English. And so one response to othering is what we call saming. In the 1960s and 70s, we used to talk about assimilation. How do we assimilate these other people? In the 1930s and 40s, we talked about the melting pot. How do we take these people from Eastern Europe who don't quite understand how to behave and have them become just like us? So it's slightly better than saying, keep them away, but it's still saying we have to, in essence, clean them up, whitewash them, make them like us. Next slide. So this is a South African word, Zulu word, sawubona, and it means, I see you. This is about belonging. I see you. I see you. We all need to be seen. And when we're seen, wonderful things happen. There's powerful research showing that when children are seen, their performance go up, they blossom. There was an example out of University of Texas, Austin, where black and Latino kids, young people, I guess I should say, were not doing well. And they spent millions of dollars to try to help them. You know, they'd gone to high schools that weren't so great. And they barely moved the needle. And then one day, a professor called the students in, one of the students in, and said, you know, what is it like for you to be here at UT Austin? And the student just let out a torrent of stuff. It's like, I don't belong here. I walk around the campus and, you know, just this it's not me. And they, at one point, I was recruited to come be at UT Austin as a professor. And they're walking me around the campus. And they're saying, you know what? There are all these Confederate memorabilia around. We fought on the side of the South in the Civil War, but don't pay attention to that. That was a long time ago. And I do enough research to realize that no matter what my pre-frontal cortex was thinking, that the reptile was saying, get the hell out of here. And I went to Berkeley instead. The point is that the school knows no one said or did anything that was, you know, inappropriate, that people were nice, but the environment was saying, this is not your place. When you come to a building that doesn't have a ramp and you're in a wheelchair, you're being told, this is not your place. So how do we say to people that this is your place? And so with these students, once the professor started talking to them, he called together black and Latino students, and all of them had similar stories. Once they start talking about identifying the othering process and start talking about belonging, the students' performance shot up. And it shot up so fast that researchers were saying, somebody must be cooking the books, because these black students can't be that smart. They thought what they were lacking was cognitive knowledge. What they were lacking was a sense of belonging. Next slide. And this has been captured many times, including by Maslow. He talks about a hierarchy of needs, and belonging being the third most important need for humans to survive. His students have actually said he has it wrong. The belonging is not the third most important need, it's the first. That you don't get safety, you don't get physiological, you don't get food unless you belong. You know, to me, this is sort of fascinating because we are connected to each other. We belong to each other. all of us came into the world physically connected to another person. It's not a metaphor, it's a reality. And even though the umbilical cord was cut, the physical connection was changed, the spiritual, emotional, psychological connection never ends. Next slide. So many of you have probably worked in the field of diversity, equity, and inclusion, and I think this has been great work, but I think belonging is the next frontier, and it has to be. That in fact, the work around diversity, equity, and inclusion really was always about belonging. And I'll talk about that, in a sense, why we needed to move from equity to targeted against versatilism and belonging. But let me just start by saying inclusion. I talk about having a party. I'm actually going to have one day, and you're invited. But this is the thing. Yes, I'm old. I'm from Detroit. So if you don't like Motown, you're not going to like the party. It's going to be a lot of Stevie and Marvin Gaye and Diana Ross, and you know, and you say, well, can't we have any, you know, like 90s music? I say, yeah, when you give your party. So inclusion is when you invite someone into your party, but it's your party. They come in as a guest. Everything is set. Now, don't be messing with the furniture. I like where that is. And that's still nice. It's still nice to go to someone's house. But at some point they say, it's 10 o'clock, it's time for you to go. I have a young woman who's coming to live with me in the fall. She wants to take a gap year, and anyway. And I say, yes, you know, you can come live at that house. I have a house that's bigger than one person needs. She's a friend of mine's daughter. And I said, but you should know, I think of myself as a fairly flexible person. But then I start, here are the rules. No meat in the house. I'm vegetarian. It's my house. You want meat in the house, get your own house. She's included, right? Belonging is not inclusion. Belonging says, it's our house. It's our party. Okay, bring your music along and we'll talk about it. Bring your food along and we'll talk about it. Bring your culture along and we'll talk about it. So people who are worried that America is changing, people who worry that England is changing. England, for the first time, majority of people in England are not Christian, for the first time in English history. And some people are freaked out. It's like, what the hell does that mean? We don't know, but it means something. Is it breaking or is it bridging? Is it a bad thing or is it a good thing? Or is it just a thing? Part of it depends on us. But inclusion, while inviting people in, how many know about Welcome America, which welcomes immigrants? And we work with them, and we said, that's great, but there's still power differential there. You're still saying, come on in to my party. You want something different. You want people to come in and co-create the thing they're joining, to co-create the library, to co-create solutions to problems that affect all of us. So belonging, next slide. So belonging moves from exclusion, inclusion, the circle is the same, to belonging. Okay, now we have something that we didn't see coming. It's very different because we're all adding to it. Next slide. And it's not just about our feelings. And I should tell you, now that you've taken a bunch of pictures on your phone, I'm going to make the slides available to you. So you can keep taking pictures if you want. Belonging is also about structures. We live in structures. Structures matter. It's not just how we treat each other personally. It's also how structures are arranged and the work that structures are doing. Next slide. So I've already talked about someone in a wheelchair. So structures are designed to do some work, but they're designed with one population in mind, unconsciously. So when you define the escalator, you're thinking of people who are ambulatory. You're not thinking about the person in the wheelchair. It doesn't mean you hate people in the wheelchair. It doesn't mean at night you run out and tip over wheelchairs. It means you're just not thinking about them. But even though you may be a good person, the escalator still makes it impossible for the person to get from one floor to the next. Structures matter. And here's one of my favorite, next slide. Think about airplanes. And you're putting up luggage on an airplane. That's a structure. So that structure works better for some groups than other groups. It doesn't work as well for shorter people. Is there a group in our society that tends to be shorter? Who are they? What? Well, certainly wheelchair people. And what about some of the people sitting in the room today? Yeah, women. And that same group tend to have less upper body strength. So now they're supposed to lift up these heavy things up over their head. And to make matters even more challenging, that same group, and this may sound controversial, but it's largely true, that same group tends to carry more luggage. So now, what do women do? Women are smart, right? So what do? They check their luggage at a disproportionate rate than their male counterparts. But here's the problem. That means they have to get to the airport an hour earlier, and they leave the airport 45 minutes later, sometimes without their luggage because it got lost. What that lesson tells us is that individual interventions to structural problems are almost always short. You can make an individual intervention, and we will, as we wait for the structures to change. But there are attacks on women still, attacks on women's time and convenience. So structural problems need structural solutions. Next slide. So we talked about breaking and bridging, and there's one other concept, which is bonding. I won't go into great detail. So bridging is when you connect with someone, and the heart of bridging is to be willing to listen. The heart of bridging is Sarabanu. I see you. Doesn't mean I agree with you, but I see you. I recognize your humanity. I recognize you have concerns. I recognize you have fears and aspirations. I'm willing to listen to those. That's bridging. And there's really powerful research saying that when bridging and recognition happen, things shift in a powerful way. Breaking is when you said, no, that person shouldn't be here. You know, I don't like the clothes they wear. I don't like their tattoos. They are somehow a threat to our neighborhood. Then there's a third concept, which is bonding, which is that where you basically care about a group without denigrating another group. So I have a really, really wonderful family. And I'm not particularly religious, but I feel blessed to have been born in the family I was born into. And I feel a little sorry for the rest of you who weren't born in that family. But I'm sure your family was okay too. So that's bonding. Next slide. So here are examples of breaking. And breaking is happening more and more. Now, breaking may seem logical if you're thinking of someone who's very, very different than you. You know, maybe you support Trump and they support Bernie. Or maybe you, are a Christian and they're not a Christian. Maybe you are a capitalist and they're a socialist. So it may seem like breaking is logical there. I want to suggest it's not. But once we start breaking, it doesn't stop. Once we start breaking closer and closer and closer to home. So even in our family, it's like a muscle. We become habituated, we become addicted to breaking. And that's what's happening in our society today. Next slide. We've talked a little bit about bonding. Next slide. And then of course, what we're advocating is that where you can, and sometimes people can't, you think about restorative justice. Sometimes people can't face someone that they're so angry at, they're so hurt, they're so traumatized. I can't be in a room with that person. Really? That's your kid? I know. Not my fault. She had him. But we have to actually deal with that. So, but I never try to talk anyone into bridging. Bridging requires vulnerability. It requires opening up. It doesn't require agreement, but it does require being present with someone. And sometimes people aren't ready for that. Next slide. So I've been talking about othering and breaking. Just one important note. There are different levels of breaking and there are different levels of othering. They're not all the same. So this is Susan Fiske's work. She's at Princeton. She actually maps the brain. When we respond to someone, it actually registers in the brain. So she has two axes. One is how competent someone is, and the other one is how much you like them, how warmly you feel toward them. And when you have someone who you like, but you don't think they're very competent, you other them. But you don't other them in the most pernicious way. You pity them. Your old uncle, who is cognitively no longer with it. I have a friend, close friend, her mother has Alzheimer's, and she loves her mother. I love her mother. But literally, her mother will say, I need to go to the bathroom. And the daughter will say, you can wait. And I say, no, you don't tell your mother to wait to go to the bathroom. Now, she's a grown woman. Yes, she's losing it, but you still need to respect her, treat her with dignity. And she's changed. She changed the behavior. So there's some people that we love, but we actually pity them. We think they're whatever. There's some people we think they're brilliant, but we don't like them. And these are national samples. In the United States, Asians tend to fall in this group. Like, yeah, they're good at math, but I'm not inviting them to my dance party. You know, I don't like hanging out with them. They're smart, but they're not cool. Then there's some people that we think of as not very smart, and we don't like them. When that happens, there's a part of the brain that lights up when we see another human being. That part of the brain does not light up for that population. And instead, the part of the brain that lights up for that population is disgust. We associate them with insects, beasts. And sometimes people who are unhoused, returning citizens, especially if they're African American, fall into that category. And I've written about this, that you can't adopt policies for people that you don't think of as people on an unconscious level. Even if you can show it's economically sound, there are certain people we despise at an unconscious level. And so part of the thing is to make sure that we see in a real way each other's humanity. And there are things we can do to do that. Next slide. And the variations in the way we bridge. I've talked a little bit about long bridges, and short bridges. The long bridge, I tell the story when I talk to Pastor McBride about bridging and about everyone being in the circle of human concern. His response to me is, "So John, are you telling me I have to bridge with the devil?" And I said, "Pastor McBride, don't start there. But also be careful who you call the devil." So oftentimes when you talk about bridging, someone will go to the most extreme example. What about the rapist who's burned my house down? You telling me I got to bridge to him? Okay, don't start there. Don't start with the most difficult bridge. That's really talking yourself out of bridging. Start, you know, it's like saying, "You know what? You know, I'm getting out of shape. So I'm going to run the marathon tomorrow." It's like, well, don't start there. When you've been sitting on the couch for 6 months, just walk around the block. And next year, maybe you'll run a half marathon. So you need to work up to this. And as you get better, as you get more in shape, you then can do longer and longer bridges. Next slide. So part of bridging and part of this work, interestingly enough, is also about our multiple identities. So you see me, you know, how many remember that case in Central Park where the woman called the police on this guy? I love that case. You know what I love about this case? So here's a black guy, right? So, you know, and so you have images that come in your mind. Okay, a black guy in the park. Is this the start of something scary? It's like, what's he doing in the park? He's a bird watcher from Harvard. It's like, she didn't see that coming. So we all have multiple identities. And we see each other, and we sometimes reduce each other to our single identity. You know, oh, she's a woman, or, you know, she can't play basketball, or whatever. And so we all have multiple identities. And when we acknowledge each other's multiple identity, it actually creates more opportunity to bridge. Oh, you like gardening? So do I. I'll tell you this story. True story. We've been bringing together Republicans and Democrats in the Senate for the last two years. And we say we can't talk politics. We're there to share each other's humanity. First, it was hard to get people to come. Now it's hard to get people not to come. It's like, when am I going to come? When am I going to and so you can't talk politics. And these are chiefs of staff for the Senate, half Democrats, half Republicans. And so one guy, so he said, tell your story. Tell us how you feel. Tell us what excites you. Tell us what bothers you. Tell us what you're grappling with as a human level, not which bill you're trying to pass. And so one guy opens up, and he starts off in this deep Southern drawl. "I'm from Mississippi. I'm 56 years old, and I've been living in D.C. for the last 3 years. I'm white. I'm old. I'm conservative. I haven't had one date. I'm lonely." That's what his story. And the whole place just melted, right? They didn't say, "Your position on the EPA is wrong." They saw him as a human being. And I can tell you there have actually been serious movements in terms of bills because people see each other's humanity. But who would have thought this tough old Mississippian was at home suffering because he didn't have a date? We all have multiple identities. And so part of bridging, part of listening to each other, part of exploring each other is to find out more about each other. When we other people, we also flatten them. You're just one thing. You're just black, just a woman. You're just gay. I may be a black gay woman, but I'm also many, many, many other things. So multiple identities help us find place to bridge. Next slide. And so we can use identities to actually connect or use identities to actually polarize. Next slide. And part of bridging and part of doing this work, and I had wonderful dinner last night with some of your city council people, including Betsy, and she was saying, we need to deal with trust. So how do you build trust at multiple levels? You're asking people to be vulnerable. We asked that guy to tell a personal story. I'm sure he hadn't told that story to many people. It's not that it's going to cost him his job, but we have to open up to each other. Next slide. And bridging, there are different ways to bridge. We can bridge from the space of being curious, of being connectors, of being innovators. We bridge from the space that we are comfortable with. Next slide. So as leaders, and all of you are leaders, formally and informally, excuse me, one of the things leaders do is they hold stories. They hold the container. Something happened. What's the story behind it? And the story is never cut and dry. And so a leader should be telling stories that have a lot of bridges associated with it. A leader should be telling stories that recognize everyone. A leader should be telling stories that invite people in. A leader should be telling stories about belonging for everyone. Next slide. A leader has power, and a leader can actually share their power with someone who has less power. I'm almost at the end, but I'll tell you another quick story since we're talking about stories. I was teaching at the University of Minnesota in big class, maybe 200 students, and this was 15 years ago, a while ago. Anyway, there were a few students in the class who were publicly gay and lesbian, and the rest of the class, many of them, not all of them, but a significant minority, were constantly making snide remarks, what we would now call microaggression. And I was trying to figure out how to interrupt that. I could try to name it, but the thing with microaggression is that when you name it, it sounds petty. You know, they didn't give me a fork at the restaurant, they gave everybody else a fork. Or they just overlooked you. Or they didn't look at you. Or they didn't shake hands with you. You're paranoid. So I was trying to figure out some other way other than just calling it out. So what I started doing is when I would tell stories about events, I'd say stuff like, me and my partner went to look at a house. And he went first, and because he was white, they said okay, and when I got there and saw I was black, they said no. And so I started telling a lot of stories, and in the stories, the suggestion was, I was in a relationship with a guy. And after about 2 weeks, five students came to my office during office hours. And they said, Professor Powell, a bunch of students in class, I mean, this doesn't matter, but you know, a bunch of students in class wanted us to come ask you if you're gay. It doesn't matter, but you know, just curious. I said, okay. I said, so what should we tell them? I said, well, tell them you asked. And that was it. There was no more microaggression toward the gay students. What I'd done was lend my power to the gay students. So if as a leader, you can lend your power. You can shift your power around. Next slide. So think about how you actually welcome people in, how you create space, how you create structures, how you share responsibility. So leader is more than just, quote unquote, the boss or the supervisor. They're actually, in a sense, curating the space. They're curating belonging, if you will. Next slide. So the stories you tell matter. Who gets to tell the stories matter. You want to make sure that all the voices are heard, all the stories are told. Next slide. And you want people to tell multiple stories from their multiple identities. when you get stuck in a single story, you're much more likely to be in conflict with others. Karen Steiner has written about this in terms of authoritarian personalities. Authoritarian personalities can't pivot. They're brittle. They're rigid. Next slide. So can we imagine a structure, a set of stories, a set of practices where everyone belongs? Can we imagine multiple identities that can accommodate different people and connect with people so that all belong? That's our challenge, and I believe you've already started that here in Spokane, and I think we'll continue that.
Maybe we could just give it up for him for a quick moment. Thank you, John.
Understand how this works when there is a severe imbalance of power. How do somebody who are subject to the severe power and the outcomes that can be devastating to their lives, how can they want to approach somebody and say, let's work on belonging? I don't know how that works. And the other thing I wanted to say, and it kind of goes along with that, is maybe the people that really need to hear this are not the people who are here today. So how do we make sure that this goes outside of, you know, kind of preaching to the choir?
And if you don't mind, we'll get all the questions out and then try to respond.
Other questions?
Hi, my name is Dempsey Jorgensen. I'm with the International Rescue Committee in Spokane. And one question that came up at our table was, you had mentioned when people are operating in fear, and you're talking about talking to your staff, encouraging them to speak to the lizard brain rather than trying to ration them out of fear. And we were wondering, what are examples of that? Like, how do you do that? How do you speak to the lizard brain? Because we were all just thinking of rational ways to do that, but that's obviously not going to be effective. So that was our question.
Hi. The question at our table was just discussing.
What?
My name? My name is Sarah. And we were just talking about how spaces like this are really helpful and really great. And also, there's a lot of people who aren't in the room who are holders of a lot of power. And sometimes spaces like this can be categorized as one political affiliation or one ideology of how to approach it, even though the concept of belonging is nonpartisan, has nothing to do with politics, right? So I think that is something we're trying to figure out, is how do we do the bridging and the belonging when a lot of folks don't even want to be in this space to have those conversations.
So there, maybe take one more. I see this woman here is doing.
I want to add to the question earlier about fear.
Could you tell us who you are?
Oh, I'm Huyan Lam. I feel like how do you address fear when fear from certain groups have become the norms? They become the common sense. So instead of even being aware that they are making policies out of fear, when that fear is legitimized and just think of, well, of course, you know, we would be fearful of this, and there's even room to challenge people's fear. But then the consequences of their fear are devastating to people.
So thank you for the questions, and I know there are many more questions, and my answers may not be complete or adequate, but let me start with the fear. So part of the thing in terms of speaking to the lizard brain is actually called the amygdala. It's the scientific name for it, which is your spirit fear response. And the amygdala actually is in lizards. So other mammals actually experience fear. And the research suggests this fear is actually probably older than and faster than love. That is that fear gets activated very easily. And it's part of it's survival, right? You know, you're walking down the road as a, and there's a snake, and it's like we have to react quickly. So that part of the brain is fast and is quick. But the one way is to acknowledge it. You acknowledge the person's existence, if you will. You don't try to talk them out of it. You listen. I can give you a concrete example. So I was invited to speak in rural Arkansas to a group, probably 500 people. My guess is everyone there voted for Trump, and they're all white. And when I walked in, there was this almost audible, like, what the hell? You know, it's like this old black guy from Berkeley. What happened? So anyway, I was trying to talk to them about the Affordable Care Act and why the state should adopt the right legislation to implement it in Arkansas. And everybody was like, we don't want to hear you, you know, we don't see you. So I started off by telling a little lie. I said, it's really great to be here. Well, really what I was saying, what the hell am I doing here? But anyway, so I said, I want to do something. I'm going to describe something, and then if it describes you, I want you to stand up. And then maybe I will even go around the room and capture some experiences. So how many of you have actually lost health insurance because you lost your job? Some people stood up. How many of you had your children denied coverage because of pre-existing condition? More stood up. I asked like two or three more questions. Then I went around and said, tell me about that. Tell me what that was like for your family. And now no one's arms are folded. Everyone's animated. And then I said, God, that must have been hard to have your kid be sick and insurance company saying there's a pre-existing condition. And they were swearing and cussing and, you know, F the insurance company. And I said, that's what the Affordable Care Act is trying to address. There was silence. Like, we heard they were trying to kill our grandmother. But I started with just acknowledging their fear and their suffering. Story is actually better than facts for talking to the lizard brain. So acknowledging people. So the guy talked about it being not getting a date. What are your feelings? Not what's your position. What are your feelings? What are your values? What do you care about? And people are great storytellers, and that's what movies are about. That's what culture is about. And the research is really quite powerful. It suggests that listening, empathetic listening, is 100 times more persuasive than argumentation. So once someone knows they're seen, sometimes people fight because they feel like there's a threat. You're saying I'm wrong, you're saying I'm stupid, you're saying I'm bad. I have to fight you for that. You're saying I don't belong. I have to fight you for that. But if you say, you know, I want to hear from you, I want to know what you care about. We've had a tremendous amount of success in this already. And there's a lot more. There's a whole, and we'll make sure it's included in some materials on how to bridge, how to listen, which is different. And that's why the thing, Sawabano, I see you. When people are seen, they can relax. But oftentimes, when people are not seen. So that's one thing in terms of dealing with the fear. But don't try to tell people the fear is irrational. Don't try to tell people the fear is wrong. But listen. Listen with compassion. Listen with empathy. And ultimately, don't even necessarily agree. We're not saying you have to say you're right. It's just that, you know, that must be hard. That must be scary.
I'll tell you one more quick story. Isabel Wilkins, who wrote the book Cass, I did an interview with her, and she talked about, she's a black woman, one of the first black women who won the Pulitzer Prize. Used to work for New York Times, rather. And she's single, and she talks about calling a plumber to come to her house. And the guy comes in, he's a big white guy with a mega hat, and he's not helping. You know, and she's a smaller black woman. In fact, he's being aggressive. He's being hostile. And she's getting frustrated because she has a plumbing problem as well. And she's trying to talk to the guy. He won't talk to her. He won't look at her. He won't help her. And then she said, for some reason, she thought to ask them this question. She says something like, "How's your mom?" And he gets quiet. And he says, "My mom died 2 years ago." And Isabel says, "My mom died 2 years ago as well." And then they start sharing the story about missing their respective moms. He's no longer just a mega guy. She's no longer just a black woman working for the New York Times. They're both children who've lost their parents. And she said everything changed. Then the guy not only fixes her pipes, he's doing extra stuff for free, right? And so part of it is, and there are skills, there are things you can learn. And you know, and I'm not trying to, you know, whatever, get more trips to Spokane, but I'd love to come back and spend time with you in terms of how do you actually do this stuff? How do you actually implement it? Not just for you, but for the community. The question about power, you're right, power matters. And I've written a paper about power, and maybe we can include that in material as well. With the stuff of bridging, the work in the United States started with Putnam. In a book, he wrote a book called Bowling Alone, and he talks about, and he doesn't deal with power because he says power distorts bridging. And so I'm gonna assume that power is relatively equal, because when you add power to the equation, it becomes complicated. He's a friend of mine, a good guy. He now says, okay, I gotta deal with power. So his recent work, he's trying to deal with power. So yes, if power is too extreme in terms of the disparities, it can distort things. And certainly you don't want someone to be overly vulnerable. You know, like if you're talking to your boss, you're not gonna be completely vulnerable if you're talking to your boss and you're worried about your job. So there's certain conditions you can create where people can talk. But there's another piece of it that's also important. Let's not, in the piece I talk about this, we should not exaggerate the power imbalance. Most of the time when groups come together, they're often, none of them have a lot of power. Most of us aren't talking to Jeff Bezos or Elon Musk or, you know, President Biden. When we talk about the white community and the black community, the Latino community, frankly, almost all of them are lacking substantial power. Not even, I'm not saying they're all the same. And even when you don't have a lot of power, you still have power. But sometimes you have to attend to power. Sometimes you have to create a condition where people can feel like they can really participate, so they can participate with the proper resources. So I don't know if I'm answering your question, but there's another question implicit in your question, which is, if I'm being harassed, if I'm being, whether it's by the police or a company official, why should I, as a, in this case, a black man, why is the burden on me to bridge? And two things I would say, or three things. One, as I said, I never try to talk someone into bridging. If you don't want to do it, don't. You know, but I would say we can't get to the kind of world we want unless we engage in much more bridging. And I was just in South Africa, and literally I talked to people who have been blown up under apartheid, and they talked about the need to bridge and love. They weren't saying, you know, I'm a powerful whatever and I've never been hurt. Loretta Ross, she wrote a book about being calling out she's a rape survivor, and she talks about a guy in prison asking her to come talk to him, and he says in this letter, "When I was outside of prison, I raped women. In prison, I raped men. I don't like myself. I need help. Will you come talk to me?" And she did go talk to him. And someone asked her, said, "But first you had to heal yourself, right?" And she said, "Absolutely no." She said, "The healing takes place in the engagement. You don't, you know, go off in a corner by yourself, get better, and then go out. It's like in the relationship." Now, in all honesty, she said, "I had to drug myself up the first time I went to prison. I couldn't, you know, I needed help." So it's not simple. But there are all these examples of people who extend themselves to people who may look more powerful, and they sometimes shift the power equation. And ultimately, you have to do this because you think it's right, because this is how you approach the world. I believe I want a world where everyone belongs. I'm not saying that my, you know, political, racial counterpart wants the same thing. When King talked about the beloved community, he wasn't saying that Lyndon Johnson was asking for the beloved community. He was saying, "These are my values. I want a world where everyone belongs." And I can tell you, I've had conversations with powerful people on the other side, and fairly successful. But again, part of it is that I do see their humanity. And in this instance, it's not calculated, right? It's not like, if I see your humanity, you'll stop being a racist. If I see your humanity, you'll be nice. If I see your humanity, you'll vote for the party I want you to vote for. What I believe is that we have to see each other's humanity, full stop, full stop. And also, I believe people who are marginalized, whether it's blacks, whites, Native Americans, they still have power. And how we use that power matters. And I, for one, believe using that power to extend to everyone, acknowledge everyone that they belong. And doing that enhances my belonging. It doesn't diminish me. It actually deepens and grounds me in my own humanity. So I know that's an adequate answer. But there are things and ways of doing this and organizing structures. And that's why I talked about leaders actually extending power. Leaders sort of create an environment where everyone belongs. So you're not sending someone off to do this all by themselves. I was sitting at a table, and one person shared about being the only one. And I mentioned a book that I'll make sure it's on the materials. There's a concept called stereotype threat, developed by a brilliant professor who's also a friend named Claude Steele. And he talks about if your group is stigmatized and you're the only one in the room out of dozens or hundreds of people, the environment creates a stereotype threat. Everybody notices you, and you notice that they're noticing you. And this whole complicated dynamic happens. And he talks about, he's written about this in a book called Whistling Vivaldi. And the book is about blacks, middle-class blacks, living in Hyatt Park, which is an upscale area in Chicago. And when they go down the street, they literally would whistle classical music to make white people feel at ease, right? And what he's saying is that that's a stress on them. They're constantly having to make, in a sense, the more powerful people feel at ease. And he talks about that as a stereotype threat. And one way he talks about dealing with it is changing the environment to have what he calls a critical mass of people so that they're not singled out. It's like, oh, there's the black woman. Oh, there's the handicapped man. Oh, there's the gay. It's like, how do you have a critical mass? Anyway, it's a brilliant book. The research has been widely cited, and it's a fun book to read. So for those of you who are grappling with that, and that case came up, and that issue came up in the Supreme Court case on affirmative action, when the court asked, how many minorities or blacks do you need? And this question is, critical mass. And there's a lot more we could say about critical mass, but I won't because of time. But Claude has some very concrete interventions as to how to deal with the stereotype threat. And stereotype threat happens primarily at unconscious level. Just to give you one sort of interesting thing. So for example, if you have black students taking standardized tests, and before the test you ask them to indicate their race, they then will perform poorly on the test because you've activated their race, and they know that blacks are not supposed to be good on standardized tests, so they underperform. Now, stereotype threats actually can be applied to anyone. So here's one of my favorite examples. He has a group of black men and white men getting ready to go play golf. And before they go play, he does something called priming, which is to activate some part of the mind. So the prime for one group is that golf, you know, golf is really not a, it's really a mental game. It's not how well you swing, or it's really strategy. It's all about planning and strategy. And now go play. In that scenario, the white men do quite well, and the black men do poorly. He takes a second group. Second group has the same ability as the first, but he gives them a different prompt. In the second group, he says, you know what? People overthink golf. It's really about natural ability. It's really about getting into your body, getting into the flow, just feeling the game. Now go play. In this case, the white guys do terrible. The black guys do well. Excuse me. They all have the same ability. What he's done is activate a threat. And so we can do this in schools. We can say to students, we send a message that your group is not good at this, and then they perform consistent with that threat. And they've affected student outcomes tremendously by the primes they use. So for those who are educators, you should be aware of how this is important in terms of education.